Morning, everybody. This is Dr. Winkler again. This is the World War I class. This is lecture 21. Moving along, making some pretty good progress right here. You can call recounting the deaths of millions of men progress. At least in our case, we are making progress in getting through the material. Last time I was just starting to discuss the Battle of the Somme. The Battle of Verdun holds a very, very strong, shall we say, attachment to the French people. I would argue very strongly that if you want to understand modern France, you're really going to have to understand the Battle of Verdun, because that really does affect the French mentality for a lengthy period of time. Can we say something similar about the Battle of the Somme as far as the British are concerned? Would it be going too far to suggest that to understand Britain is very helpful if you understand the Battle of the Somme? Of course, both in the case of France and Britain, there are numerous other battles that are going to take place and campaigns within World War I. But for some reason, the British do remember the Somme in a very similar manner as do the French remember Verdun. Well, what's happened here? At the beginning of the war in August 1914, of course, the British Army is too small. So there's a call for volunteers. The initial call was for 100,000 men to come forward and volunteer. Within 5 months, the British had over 2 million volunteers. Now, that many men pushed into the military at one time, when the military is actually configured for a much smaller army. It takes a while to outfit these guys. It takes a while to train these men. Of course, you do tend to shove them into France. Haig has this brilliant idea. He thinks it's a brilliant idea that he can get enough men on the Western Front, this 2 million man army that by the summer of 1916 is well trained. These men know what they're supposed to do. They're just not well experienced. Very few of them have actually already seen battle. Well, they're going to see battle in a really big way, very, very fast. So this is the big push. Haig thinks that he can break the Western Front. Now, initially, the plan was this. You're going to have a large contingent of British. Remember, these 2 million men have come forward now, and we got a really good chance now of doing some very good work. The idea initially, of course, was to have the French there in very large numbers as well. Now, the French do participate in the Battle of the Somme, but the real huge numbers that Haig was hoping for and anticipating are really not there, because the French are bogged down at Verdun and don't have enough units to spare to really make this a British and French show. The French are there, but it's largely a British show. Many more men from Britain are represented at the battle than is the case of French. I've already mentioned this last time. One of the ideas here was to relieve the pressure on Verdun. That's part of the issue. In fact, the French make an appeal in June, late in June, actually, of 1916, saying, you've got to do something. The British have to become involved quite rapidly, or the French army is going to suffer too many casualties. As soon as Haig hears this, he starts the preparatory bombardment before the big push, before this is it, before the men go out in large numbers. Well, what is the plan? I floundered around last time trying to find a good map of the Battle of Verdun. I was playing around with this before I started a lecture. I'm not really sure even yet I've come up with something that's very quite helpful. Nonetheless, what we see on a stretch of about 17, 18 miles of the Western Front, this is where the British are holding this. Remember, this is largely at that bulge in the lines, in the Western Front lines. The whole idea here is to get through the Germans, to pound through. Now, Haig believes that he can do this very rapidly. Actually, the army that's involved in this is the 4th Army. And the 4th Army is led by General Rawlinson. We say Haig's ideas, but Rawlinson is actually the person who, shall we say, is more intimately involved in exactly setting up what's happening. So when I talk about Haig, I can also be referring to Rawlinson. Any event, the idea is to break through. I forget how many divisions, about 8 divisions that the British had of cavalrymen. You see, they're going to get through here into the German rear areas. And rather than having men just march through and gain positions, let's get mobility. And mobility in this case is cavalry. Now, we really don't hear much about cavalry during the First World War. One of the reasons for this is it's almost completely ineffective. Oh, it's tried. Can we say not very often, but they do try it in different manners. I mean, you get horses out running against, well, they're going to have the same problem as men on foot. Are they going to get through the barbed wire? Are they going to get through the enemy fire? And remember, a man on a horseback, you include the man and the horseback, they're pretty big target. Since you're up higher off the ground, if a shell goes off nearby, artillery from your enemy, you're going to have a problem. You're going to easily hit the horse and knock the man over. So actually, they're a bigger target. This is tried on a few occasions. Let's hit them. Gentlemen, let's hit them before sunrise. Can't really see yet. Maybe this will scare the Germans, whatever. Doesn't work. Can we say the use of cavalry in the First World War is much overrated? That there is no real, in 1916 even, there's no real belief, shall we say, that this can work. It has not been demonstrated that it can work. Let's put it this way. It's a bad idea. It's a waste of resources. But that's the plan. Now, as the battle unfolds, we're going to find out that there's never a breakthrough. There's never a point when the British are in open country. There is never a point when you can actually deploy the cavalry. So these guys are sitting next to their horses day after day, week after week, doing nothing. Wasted resources. Well, for this an attack on this scale, and we're talking huge numbers of men, of course the Germans are going to find out that they're building up. Of course, Germany has reconnaissance aircraft flying around and various sources of intelligence. They know the British are building up. Obviously, they're building up. They're not just doing this for show. They mean to do something with it. So the Germans have plenty of time to react. They move up additional units. They dig their bunkers deeper. And they also enhance the trench network that's right behind the lines. Remember, I said there are times when the trench networks have like 5 different levels of trenches behind no man's land. This isn't always the case, but often it is. And this is a good example where the Germans had a couple, 2-3 lines of trenches and built another line along this area. Now, we have an objective. We have a goal. We're going to have a breakthrough. We're going to go in and wipe out those Germans. However, later, as this bogs down, and it bogs down severely in a very real way, when this bogs down, later on, Hay is going to say, oh, by the way, the breakthrough was not necessary. We're actually fighting this to kill Germans. So the idea of attrition comes in. We're killing enough Germans to break, or shall I say, weaken their war effort and eventually break them down. But this only comes in after the severe failure of what's going on. Okay, so the idea was to shell the German positions for 5 days. They let loose British guns, now different kinds of calibers. Some of them are good howitzers, which are in a position to do damage to trenches. Lighter guns, the 18-pounders, are better to take out men in open field, very much like the French 75s. Some of these guns, therefore, are not helpful when you're actually blowing apart trenches. Now, I said 5 days. Notice I have seven up here. After 5 days, it rains. Like the day before they were supposed to go over, it rains. It rains quite heavily, actually. And Rawlinson says, talks to Haig, says, look, we can't do this. It's too wet. Let's put it off. So they agree, sure, we'll do this. We'll wait 2 more days. So the shelling continues. Now that becomes a problem because after shelling for 7 days, you're running out of shells. And if you start putting this off, do you really have enough artillery to support your attack? So now we have shelling for 7 days rather than five. Ineffective, largely ineffective. We believe that about 1.5 million shells in the 7 day period are used to shell the German positions. One estimate, I don't know how they know this, one estimate said that as many as 1/3 of these were duds. I already talked about the shell shortage, that people are manufacturing shells at a very rapid pace. When they manufacture shells too rapidly, quality control goes down. When quality control goes down, you can have problems with fuses that detonate the bomb, the shell, a little later than it should be, or a little earlier. Remember, I already mentioned this. If it detonates earlier, it's right over your own men. You can kill your own men with your own artillery. Of course, there are many accusations during the war, not just here. When artillery is not well coordinated with the men on the ground, and you actually do kill your own men with your own artillery. 1.5 million shells, that's an awful lot of throw weight. But when you take out 1/3 duds, then you do see that there is a problem of how effective this is going to be. Sometimes they're using wrong kinds of shells. I made a big deal about shrapnel. Remember, this is anti-personnel. You come over, the thing explodes, all these balls go all over the place, and they do severe damage to a lot of people. Shrapnel is not good to blow apart a trench. Shrapnel is not good to blow apart barbed wire. In fact, when the shells come down and shrapnel hits barbed wire, the barbed wire goes twang, still there. To take out barbed wire, you need heavy explosive materials. You need shells that blow up. Even at that, remember, barbed wire is pretty sturdy stuff. It can simply reconfigure the barbed wire. In some places, it's intact. Now, I'm not going to say there aren't places where the shelling does not take out the barbed wire. In fact, there are places where it does. But largely, in many areas, the barbed wire remains intact. So when you're shelling the German positions, all this trouble with barbed wire, if you're coming up as an infantryman to that, and you're expecting that to be gone, and then you have this sea of barbed wire in front of you, how do you get through? I'm not even sure how many men had wire cutters. You see, there was a tendency, and this becomes extremely important, helping us understand what happened. You have men coming in, and you have a sea of barbed wire, and you can't get through on the front where you're supposed to get through, where you're supposed to be attacking. But there is a place to your left, to your right, wherever, where there is actually a place where the shelling was effective in taking out the barbed wire. It's very difficult for you to push through the wire. You really can't do this. So you have a tendency to pull over in either one direction or another to get to where there's spaces. This confuses units because you get units intermingled. But more importantly, what you've done is you've funneled the men coming in. So you have broad numbers of men coming in. And then you funnel them down to a small area, which becomes a much, much easier place for the Germans to either use artillery or to use machine guns to tear to shreds. Sometimes when the British are leaving their trenches, one thing you have is barbed wire, of course. And you've got to go out and clip off all the barbed wire so the men can get through. Another indication, if you're the Germans looking at the other side saying, they're cutting down their barbed wire. I wonder if they're coming. Of course they're coming. In some cases, rather than taking up 17, 18 miles of barbed wire, the men are expected to have a few groves of barbed wire. So the men actually leave the trenches, not going up always frontally, though they do as often as they can. Sometimes they're funneling them a little bit when they're coming out of their own trenches, which slows them down and also gives the Germans an additional place to set their artillery and their machine guns. Too few heavy guns. I've already mentioned this. The light artillery pieces are ineffective. They need large guns. They need howitzers. It's very interesting to take this from the perspective of the British. But could you imagine what this is like on the German side? Even though some of this shelling is ineffective, the Germans are not, physical casualties are not as strong here. Because the Germans, remember, are in dugouts. They've even dug a little bit deeper when they have really good reason to believe the British are coming and coming in a very large attack. The shelling is intensive enough that when the British look out, they can't even see the German trenches anymore. The German trenches are literally obliterated. You say, well, everybody has to be dead. Well, unfortunately, you don't have to be dead because you can be in a hole in the ground. Not only do they literally blow up the German trenches, but there's the communication trenches, as I've already mentioned, that come up behind where you get your supplies. And they're obliterated as well. The Germans are sitting in their holes for days. After a while, your food runs out. After a while, you can't get clean water brought up. For days, you do not sleep. You can't cleanse yourself. You're just simply under the constant shelling. One German account says, all we had was our rats and our lice, and everything else was getting blown to scrub. Now, under those circumstances, you have men cracking up. You have men, fear, deprivation, lack of sleep. You're gonna have some severe problems. In the book, All Quiet on the Western Front, remember it's a novel, Remarque just mentions, as I recall, in passing, oh, we were under shelling for 7 days at the Somme. He virtually lets it go at that. It's kind of like a reflection. In the 1930 version, motion picture, of All Quiet on the Western Front, the motion picture producers take a little bit more license, and they actually take us in the German dugouts during the shelling. And one of the things that's so very, very impressive about that section of the motion pictures, it starts to depict what's happening to these men and how some of the men start cracking up. Well, that's true, but that doesn't mean, we can obviously argue that their fighting efficiency has gone down. No doubt about that at all. But to mean that they are, to say that they really are not in a position to defend themselves, that's not even close to true. You see, when the Germans are preparing for the British attack, they have them in their dugouts and they practice over and over again. get that machine gun up, get in a position, get ready to fire, bang, bang, bang. They're pretty fast at it. And sometimes these men are being shelled, and they know the British are going to attack. Wouldn't it be great if they just started to attack and we get all this over with? Blow up German positions. Go to YouTube. One of the more fascinating things, I think, about the Somme is that a motion picture crew was brought up. So we actually have a motion picture. It's not a motion picture from the standpoint that there's a plot and we have people running around. It's just really what's happening. And it was shown in British theaters later in the year and also in the United States. We have actual footage of what's going on here. The film, and you can watch the whole thing right here. I've done it several times. It is really quite fascinating what they are showing. Now, as you can see from looking at these guys right here, a lot of this is, and down here as well, a lot of this is people just marching to and from the front. It's really fun. These guys are marching. They're busting before the camera. Hey, guys. Hi. Of course, that's going to bring a lot of attention. Some guy pulls out a camera. People are certainly going to look in that direction. We see what these men look like when they go up. We see what these men look like when they come back. We see the heavy guns. We even show the mines. You see, in Britain, of course, one of the ways that the British are making money is by mining coal, largely in Wales and other places, largely in the west of England. However, you have men with a lot of expertise in digging tunnels, digging into the ground. These are miners. So you dig in under a redoubt. Usually your doubt is a more heavily occupied place. And you dig a tunnel underneath there and you hollow out a little room. And then you pack this with dynamite. And then you blow it up. And these things can be quite enormous. Huge holes. I've seen this. What has happened to, not everything, but a lot of places on the Western Front. Remember, Verdun is never, you cannot go back and farm Verdun. The soil has either been poisoned or it's been blown away. One of the reasons why the French have not rebuilt the area, you can't. However, in many other areas, remember, France is a very good farm country. You can, and it takes years after the war is over. It takes a couple of decades. Actually, we usually say the French started to fill in the trenches in 2018. They were not done 2018. How about 1918? And they're not done until 1940. It takes like 22 years. So there's all kinds of features. They're actually still there, but they're covered up. So we can't see them unless you want to play archaeologists, go and dig them up. However, there were a few places where an Englishman, in this case, bought the ground and did not allow the crater to be covered up. So on July 1st, when the battle took place, one of these craters was blown up a German position. And it's something of a tourist location now. When I was there, the buses are coming in. I'm renting my car. It's got to be raining. You know, it always rains on me. It's raining, but I got out here and I go, my goodness, the size of this thing. Remember, it's had 100 years now from, shall we say, normal rain patterns to start sloughing this off. So it's probably not as stark as it was before. Now, I'm trying to give you a size of scale here. It's a little hard to do. You see these people right here? You see, this thing is huge. No doubt about that at all. Actually, there is another shell hole, which is near where the Canadians went across. And that's on private land. It's covered with trees. I remember seeing it from a distance, but it's not really the tourist place where you can go over and look at it. But Union Idea look even a few hundred yards away as to the size of this thing. We actually have some footage of this thing blowing up. Let's go back to, I think if I looked at this long enough, now what this is simply a compilation of some of the more stunning things we're going to see over here. But let's take a look and see if I can show you the blowing up of this thing. Notice this is 12 seconds. Now, this footage has not been enhanced. In other words, it hasn't been clarified. But you get an idea what this thing looked like. Camera crew stood there on the morning. Let's go back, show you again. If there's anything over there, they're dead. No way a German could possibly survive that. One more time. So, does this bust a hole in German lines? Of course it does. But does this really help you? It does help you right there, but does this help you get a breakthrough? The initial attack, this is very well remembered by the British, was July 1st, 1916. The British troops have been told it's a cakewalk. Well, it looks like it looks like it to them as well. I mean, this is almost something that the guys just enjoy looking at. You see, the Germans aren't firing back, particularly after dark. You can imagine what show it would be like. So the guys are standing up on top of the trenches. They're looking over at the German positions, and boom, 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 boom. You can imagine what kind of show that would be. And the German positions are no longer visible. In other words, the trenches are gone. Now, of course, you're going into a battle situation. The field, no man's land, by the time you get the German trenches, have a lot of obstacles, in other words, shell holes in them. If you want to keep your units together, wouldn't it be better just simply have everybody go up to the front? Now, everybody knows that when you get up to the enemy position, the equipment that you need to support yourself with is back, and it's across no man's land, and there can be all kinds of problems with traffic and disruptions. So it's very helpful for have the men carry what they need. It's like 240 rounds of ammunition. Bullets are heavy. That alone would be quite heavy. Some of the men have picks, some of the men have shovels. You're carrying no food for a couple of days. You have your canteen. You got to have some decent water. Now, you do, I've read this in different books. Sometimes they'll say they had 60-pound packs or 70-pound packs. Now, you can walk with a 60 or 70-pound pack, but it's going to be very difficult to run carrying that much material. The idea is that if we are successful, the men would have to walk a few miles in the first hours of the first day. And in doing so, they have a pretty good chance that they're just simply going to push right in. So you don't need the ability to run. You don't need the ability to dodge. To keep you in a cohesion, line them up, go in straight lines. There's always a fear that the men might bunch up. Keep them straight. Could you imagine an easier target for a machine gun to look at than a straight line of men walking toward your position? The attack is to take place at 7:30 in the morning. initially, the first hour, like 60,000 men are going to go forward. We do say that later on, when additional attacks are taking place, it's up to 100,000 men. Now, once again, which book do you want to read? There are some books that say that it actually was 120,000 men. Well, I'm old school. When I first was reading about this, it was 100,000, so let's leave it 100,000. With the caveat, there could have been actually more men involved. How many Germans are available to fight? Now, remember, we're talking 17 or 18 miles of front. An estimate, we can't be sure of this, maybe 100 machine guns? What's that? 5 per mile or something like that? Doesn't seem like an awful lot. Of course, there's infantrymen, German infantrymen, they got high-powered rifles with their Mausers and they're shooting at you. The British come out in rows. The Germans come out with their machine guns, can fire 10 rounds a second, and simply mow them down. They're simply shot to pieces. Now, remember, these guys are having a difficult time running and dodging with a 70-pound pack on their back. And when you have these lines of men, of course, when all these men start going down, then the men who are still standing and looking around and seeing what's happening, or if you're in the second wave, seeing what happened to the men up front, then you're going to start doing desperate things. You're going to leave your lines and you're going to try to, shall we say, run as best you can, move as best you can, dodge as best you can. But with that kind of weight on your back, that becomes challenging. Some of the men simply throw their packs off so they have a better chance of moving around. They're simply cut to ribbons. The power of the machine gun has never been better demonstrated. Now, let's not be too narrow on this, because the British actually had also fought, they had knocked out the German guns. The heavy, heavy shelling had taken care of the German guns. Once again, I'm sure German guns were taken out, but the German artillery is essentially intact. And the Germans have had a couple of years to practice on this. They're very good at leveling out a barrage. So as the men are getting slaughtered by the machine guns, then you also have the German guns coming over and tearing them to shreds. You see, one thing I didn't point out earlier, if you're advancing in the machine gun, one of the ways you get out of a machine gun is to hit the dirt, literally on the ground. But then if you have explosive shells, like the German 77, is anti-personnel, it comes over and you're laying flat on the ground, so your back is a complete target, then you come over shrapnel and the shrapnel is... So a combination of these things is extremely lethal for the British. Once again, I'm old school, 100,000, might have been more. Of these 60,000 casualties, this is one day. Remember I said the initial attack was with 60,000 men? Within 1 hour, 30,000 of those men, one half, had been killed or wounded. The remaining 30,000, you're going to try to reorganize yourself. You're going to try to run out and maybe continue the advance, because then you have other waves coming in, coming up to eventually the entire 100,000 men. So even though you're having extremely heavy casualties in 1 hour, you actually end up with 60,000 in one day. Remember, they start attacking at 7:30 on July 1st. By the time the sun goes down, 60,000 casualties. Among these are 20,000 dead. Usually, remember, in World War I, we largely have a 2-to-1 ratio. For every man that's killed, you have 2 that are wounded. And this is a good example of this, because we have 20,000 dead and 40,000 wounded, ending up being this 60,000. The scale of this is terrific. The scale of this is enormous. Sometimes, if we were meeting in person, I like to ask this question. Now, I don't really expect my students to know, but I'm trying to get them thinking a little bit. Can anybody, for example, tell me, of course, the biggest war the United States has ever been involved in is the Second World War. Oh, well, I guess maybe you can make a good case for the Civil War. But let's throw it out this way. What was, in the Second World War, the most costly battle U.S. forces ever fought? We had some pretty costly battles. However, the most costly one was the Battle of the Bulge. It took about 6 weeks, starting in December 16th, 1944, ending later in January, for the United States to suffer its highest casualties. 6 weeks, about 70,000 U.S. casualties. One thing that's slightly misleading about this is 20,000 of those are frostbite. It's a big scandal. They sent men up with good shoes that could withstand the cold, and the men in the back lines got them, while the men in the front are wearing shoes that aren't properly insulated, that leading to a big problem with frostbite. But wait a minute, let's take the frostbite out for a second and say 50,000 casualties in 6 weeks. The British exceeded that on the first day of the Somme in a matter of hours. When you talk about slaughters, this is a very good example. As you drive around France, this area, there are a few places where, like I said, over here you have the crater.
I'm Joshua Hamlin in front of the Loch Nagar mine crater on July 1st.
I'm glad you're there, buddy. Okay. Let's go back and maybe show you a little bit more film, however. Go back to YouTube. Give you an idea of what we're looking at here. I urge you to take a look at this. Notice for dramatic effects. Notice for dramatic effects. They're playing the piano. I think that's helpful, but when I'm trying to lecture, it's a little bit irritating, I think. I set this on this point of the film last night, because I want to show you what I think is one of the most moving pieces of footage in the entire First World War. Can we go back just a little bit here? Guys are moving up. Remember, you're busting for the camera. Everybody's got to take a look around. North of the chalk. Remember the chalk, the white area over here. The British are moving up. Now, British Tommy's rescuing a comrade in a shell fire. This man died 30 minutes after reaching the trenches. You're bringing in the wounded. You're bringing your buddies, and he's going to die anyway. You can imagine how awful that would be. You're out in the countryside here. Now, that little intro right there said it's under shell fire. I'm not seeing the evidence of this. In fact, what I think I'm seeing is there's probably Germans within eyesight of this. I mean, you're walking across the field. It's pretty hard not to see these guys. Could you kill these men? Sure. Maybe they chose not to. But let's go on. You're carrying a man off. There were thousands of men by the end of July 1st laying wounded in no man's land who had, if they had been given proper treatment, they would have survived. But you can't get them off. It's too challenging. It's too dangerous. Or you simply don't have the means to retrieve them in time. One of the reasons why I think the casualty figures, that there's so many dead versus the number of wounded, that in reality, a lot of the problem is just getting them to proper treatment as rapidly as you can. And we're back in, and we're back down the trenches. Let's go back here a little bit. So I can get to some of these scenes. Now, all this was taken from that larger film, about 9 or 15 minutes. So we're just talking about 3 minutes here. See the guys marching up, getting. Of course, you got the horses and priest telling him you're going to die anyway. Actually, he's not saying that at all. He's trying to give them some spiritual comfort. The music is Andrew Lloyd Webber's Requiem. Notice the shellfire? That's what it actually looks like when the shells come in. Before you go over, you can smile. Notice the size of the shells. Man, that thing's huge. Didn't have enough of them. Give your bayonets on. Remember, you gotta practice with those figures of straw. There's the explosion of the mine, which I've already shown you. Once again, shell fire, no man's looking. Look what it looks like when the shells hit. This is the crater I showed you. It still exists. Setting up machine guns. To see on that last scene right there, they are elevating the guns. The German machine guns, British machine guns as well. You could actually kill a man at 3,000 yards. Of course, you're not going to do that flat trajectory. You're going to have it up to a certain length, a certain extent. Guys, just hanging around. I'm going to show you some other film here. Going up, yes, come on. Now, camera sitting back here, and this officer right here, remember, he's waving a stick. So I can get that back again. He's waving a stick. Now, very often they blow a whistle. Remember, a lot of times these guys have pistols, but he's got a stick, and these other men going up are carrying rifles. If you're a German over there and you're going to kill somebody, that's the first man you're going to kill, if you have a choice. Go back just a couple seconds, and show you this again. Well, that was a little more awkward than I was hoping it would be. Notice the man went up. His head just barely got above the parapet. He's right here. The other men are going over. He got his head up. It's going back down. Now, he could clearly be faking it. And I'm not sure that didn't happen on numerous occasions. But now we've got men walking through this, apparently their own wire. As you can see, it really hasn't been cut down entirely. Of course, you can step over it, but that's going to slow you down. So let's take a look at the men stepping through the wire. Got a man. Watch him fall. Maybe a little better quality than what we saw before. Bringing in German prisoners. What I also wanted to show you was the guns laying out bodies. Thank you. one thing I was hoping to show you, which you did not, was the guns. The big, heavy howitzers being fired. I know this is kind of a fool's errand. Let's hope I don't waste too much time. Once again, you can see the shells. I don't want to take too much of valuable lecture time looking for something that might be hard to find. Let's see if I can show you some guns being fired. Okay. There we go. Does not have recoil mechanism. Well, I showed you a gun being fired. Once again, seeing the shells go off in the distance. Well, take an hour and 13 minutes some time and watch all of this. You're going to learn an awful lot more from a few minutes of watching some film than ever trying to visualize it. Talk about 400 British cemeteries. Once again, the trenches have been filled in. There are a few places where you can actually go out and see where the combat took place. I will come back to one in just 1 minute. But 400 British cemeteries. You're driving around this area. And they're just all over the place. Well, I mean, some are bigger than others. Right here at Thiepval, when the positions the British tried to take and failed, well, they took it days later. Congratulations, you know, a couple of miles. There's over, was it 58,000 men, something like that, whose graves are not known. So they built this monument to the British dead, and they have, you can walk inside here. I've been here. You walk around, you can see just names on names on names. And of course, graveyards do mean that you actually had a corpse to bury. I was in the city of Albert in France. It's right in the center of the Somme battlefield. I got me my hotel. I'm stressed out of my mind. Can't even find a place to buy gas. Can't even make people understand. The guy running the hotel, I says, where do you buy gas? He has no idea what I'm talking about. My French is non-existent. His English is even worse. Any event, I kind of hooked up with a guy there, an Englishman. His name was Derek. And he wanted somebody to help him read maps, and I was more than pleased to have somebody drive me around. So I went to Thiepval by myself. I did find this by myself. Yeah, it's raining, it's cold. Very moving experience. He said his grandfather, Derek's grandfather's name's on this. Because the Battle of the Somme, he was, well, there was nobody. Or nobody anybody found, could find. Or they simply buried the body someplace. Or he was blown to smithereens. I offered him my sympathy. Sorry about your grandfather. He said, oh, yeah, it's no big deal. I said, it's a big deal. Because you never got to know him. A family member you never got to know. Yeah, he didn't disagree with that. Graveyards all over the place. I mean, you drive and drive and just graveyard, 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 graveyard. I had a map brought with me of the Battle of the Somme. And the roads don't follow the where the battle actually took place, so you got to go around here. This is before I was with Derek, and I'm driving around. And they're just all over the place. One of the things I want to talk about in driving around, which taught me a whole lot. You see, this is rolling country. I was actually surprised. What if the British had broken through? They did not. What happened where they broken through? Yeah, you can say your maneuver. You're out of the trenches. But since it's rolling country, what if the Germans got on top of another hill? Now, they don't have the trenches at that time. They would not have had the trenches at that time. They wouldn't have had the barbed wire. But what have you accomplished? I got thinking, I'm not sure a breakthrough would have worked very well. It's just all over the place. 400 of them. I can't even say I scratched the surface. They're well maintained. They look pretty good. At least they show the dead that much respect. Well, some French success. Yeah. The French have been doing this for a couple of years. Some of the British troops have been fighting, but largely these men are untrained. Untrained. I keep saying the wrong words. These are men that are well trained, but with little experience. The French have had some experience. They have this huge attack with the British north of the Somme, and farther down south, you have the French. The French have some success. I'm not going to say they ever had total success. But they did not have quite the slaughter. Now, they're going to suffer badly in the battle. They're going to continue to attack. The Germans are going to continue to resist them and shell them and counterattack. But what the French had actually done, rather than standing up in rows and going in where machines can take care of you very easily, the French had actually gone out into no man's land. And they got men laying down in the shell holes and sometimes just on the ground. But they're much closer to the German positions. So when they're given the order to attack, they don't have to cross so much no man's land. They're closer to rush in. So they can get in, at least this works in a few cases, they can actually get in the German trenches before the Germans do not have the, can run out and start defending themselves. I mean, can't the British and French talk to each other? We say the French are better at this in 1916 than the British are. One of the things that the British had tried was the what we call the creeping barrage. I talked about the roving barrage in another context. The idea is the guns are behind you several miles. They're behind you. And the shells go over, landing right in front of you. In other words, you're walking in before the Germans can react. You could imagine under a chaotic battle situation that sometimes the British, if they move too fast, their own artillery will take them out. If they move too slowly, well, then the barrage gets in front of them. You see, you're too far in front of them. You can see how challenging this would be. Let me throw in a story here since I'm talking about creeping barrages and your own artillery hitting your own men. When I was a kid growing up, there was a man lived all street over from me. And he was a World War I veteran. And he had a pretty good career. He was kind of head of the Twillis School Board. And remember him talking on more than one occasion about his military experiences. He said at Verdun, now this is, I got to be a little careful about this. He's with the American combat troops. The Americans did not fight as combat troops at Verdun. Yes, there were some people in the Lafayette Escadrille flying above the battlefield. There were some Americans that were actually driving ambulance vehicles, wounded, taking them back to the hospitals. So Americans were there, but not really as combat troops. So in saying Verdun, he's a little misleading. However, the United States combat troops, when you are looking at Verdun, the Americans are deployed at Meuse-Argonne, right here. He said that he saw a whole company of U.S. soldiers wiped out by their own artillery. I don't pretend to know everything about World War I. I consider myself to be somewhat knowledgeable. I've never run across this in any other place. However, if that's actually true or he's slightly exaggerating or whatever, there are numerous occasions where we read about friendly, they're going to call this in Vietnam, friendly fire, your own artillery taking out your own men. So fire coordination using artillery on your enemy positions to protect your men, that can lead to some severe problems. Well, Haig's trying to figure out what to do. And Haig uses tanks for the first time. Tank. Sometimes we give Churchill credit for this. He didn't really configure a tank. He didn't really make one. He just came up earlier in the war with the idea of why can't we have a tractor, a mobile device that's encased in metal so the people inside can't be hurt. That's a pretty good idea. It's going to be extremely important in World War II. World War I, the British come up with, you start out with the Mark I. The defense on the Mark I is boilerplate. I mean, it's not very thick. And that might deflect a machine gun bullet. Of course, you develop the Mark II, the Mark III, the Mark IV. You do get a number of these things throughout the war. The idea is probably pretty sound. Though, mechanically, we have problems with these things. They're slow. They really can't walk faster than a man. Now you say, well, that looks kind of odd. The reason for this is you want to have the ability to go over a trench. And trenches are like this. So you want something that will go up and over them. You go over a trench without falling in and getting stuck there. You can see that you have a gun sticking out on either side. But they're slow. They're mechanically unreliable. Almost inevitably in tank attacks during the First World War, these things break down. There's not adequate ventilation. Of course, the motor has to be inside. You got men inside with the motor. It can easily go up over 100 degrees, 110, 120 in there, which can be debilitating and quite stifling for the men involved. With inadequate ventilation, sometimes they're not expelling the carbon monoxide from the engine well enough. I don't know if I'd mention this because I'm not sure I quite believe it, but I have read that in some tank attacks, more men died within the tanks because of the carbon monoxide than actually were killed by enemy fire. Do they make a difference? That's controversial. We'll come back and talk about them later. Almost in a desperation move, however, Sir Douglas Haig uses tanks on September 15th. They do not make much difference. It is, can we say, at least initially, it's a secret weapon. The reason why we call them tanks is as a code word. Because if you call them tanks, well, maybe the Germans will think you're talking about water tanks. So that's how you come up with a kind of an odd name for this weapon. The Germans call them Panzer, which means armor, which maybe is a better description. They're ineffective at the Somme, do not accomplish much of anything. And however, the enemy knows, Germans are really slow in picking up on this. Can we put it this way? The Germans could have known or should have known. However, they don't pay much attention. Well, how do you take these things out? Artillery is the best way to get them. As I'm criticizing all this, we do have an issue of the inflexible plan. Let's go back to Rawlinson. Rawlinson is responsible for the Fourth Army. He's back at his command headquarters. It's not a total failure everywhere. There are some areas, particularly in the southern area of the Battle of the Somme, where the British actually reached a few trenches and actually took a few trenches. There's some success there. Of course, you want to react rapidly if you have some success, if you're trying to exploit that success. What Rawlinson does is, well, we have a plan. To alter that plan is a bad idea. So the plan becomes inflexible. The successes are not properly followed up on. failure to react to situations, slaughter continues. Reinforce failure. It didn't work on July 1st. Let's read attacks on July 2nd. See, maybe, shouldn't the Germans be pushed back? Because the Germans are rushing in reinforcements by July 2nd. Should you not have, well, maybe they'll break. Going back to the Marne in 1914, the Germans are telling Moltke back in Germany, we're doing well. Moltke doesn't believe it for a number of reasons. And what we're seeing is that they're saying we're capturing the Germans. When the men are ordered up, there's always a fear that some of the men won't go. The British are using what I call murder squads. The guys, when the British go up, if you find them or linger, some guy hanging back, maybe not left the trenches, your squads come down and you kill them. You didn't go up, you're a coward. If this is known by the men who are going up, they'll say, well, it's better to take my chances against the German guns, have a better chance of surviving, than sitting back in the trench and having my own men kill them. When the men cross no man's land, and they suffer very heavy casualties, sometimes within a matter of hours, when they are successful in taking German trenches, then the Germans, some of these guys never fired a shot, some of them are dazed, and they try to surrender. We have account by account of the British shooting these men as they beg for their lives. Now, remember, these are not your highest level combat troops in the German army. These tend to be older men. They tend to be reservists. The best troops have probably been slaughtered at Verdun or in other sectors. Though this is not considered a quiet sector by the Germans, you have to put your middle-aged men someplace because you have to have them. Many of these men are married. They pull out pictures of their wives and their children. They beg for their lives. You don't have to know any German at all to know what Kamerad means. Comrade, friend. And a lot of the Germans know at least a few English words like mercy. With all these accounts of the men holding up their pictures. And the British killing them anyway. This is to make up for the guys, my buddies just got killed a few minutes ago out in the trenches. I should say crossing no man's land. As a point of interest here, this is on the first day. This did happen. I've alluded to this in an earlier lecture. This did happen that at times there are these spontaneous truces. And sometimes they were formal truces. We won't fire for an hour or 2 hours to give you the opportunity of pulling your wounded off. See, if this happens, the men who can get treatment and will live have a chance to survive. This happens in a few places on July 1st. And the British are slaughtered. They're calling out, call off the battle for an hour or two. Give us a chance to pull our wounded off and give a chance to save them. When this happened in one place, the Germans left their trenches. They walked down to where the British wounded were. They didn't say a word. This is not fraternization. The Germans left their trenches, walked down, and helped the British carry off their wounded. When this brief truce was over, the Germans are back in their trenches. And the battle continues. Haig pushes the attack. Once again, maybe the Germans will break. They don't. The attacks go on July, August, September for 4 months until November 18th, 1916. When finally bad weather, winter, rain, finally bad weather, Haig has to call it off. What was accomplished? There were objectives in front of the British positions that were supposed to be taken on the first day. After more than 4 months later on, these positions had not been taken. I like a quote from Albert Einstein. Insanity is doing the same thing over and over again. Let me start over again. Albert Einstein said, insanity is doing the same thing over and over again, expecting different results. Haig does this over and over and over again, expecting different results. Reality, you get the same results. One of these areas, and I've read different things about this. I've read that the French gave this to the Canadians. I've also read that the Canadians bought this from France. When I was in France several years ago, I got to Vimy Ridge, which was Canadian owned. And I also got to, is this my Metz Woods? Anyway, there's a Canadian memorial. Actually, it's Newfoundland. The Newfoundlanders were in the trenches and they attacked. See, let me show you what you're talking about. Oh, this is really, really quite fun. They had young ladies there, very knowledgeable. Oh my goodness. You could ask these young women anything. They knew it. Very impressive. Of course, they speak perfect English. They speak perfect French. The visitor center is over here. That's usually where you talk to the young ladies. And sometimes they'll walk out with you a little bit. The parking lot is back here beyond the trees. Now, of course, the trees weren't there in 1916, but the Canadians moved out here. It's relatively level right here. The guns were back behind them, artillery, and they moved out here. One battalion, 950 men. Talking right here to the young ladies. And I said, how many machine guns do the Germans have on this position? She said 5. I looked out across that field. When the Canadians left their trenches, it kind of angles down. So when you angle down in an attack, the higher ground in the distance has the opportunity of shooting down on you. So you've got the machine gun shooting down on them. 5 machine guns. I looked out of that and says they didn't have a chance. They got 100 yards. All Germans were good. They killed all the officers. The men didn't know the plans. They didn't know what else to do. By the time the sun went down, maybe 110 of them were left without being killed or wounded. Some of the trench areas, of course, over the years, they're not nearly the trenches like they used to be. Gives you an idea of what went on. Little gained, a few miles. Now, this is controversial. How many men actually died in the battle? Remember, I gave you some indication as to the problems with estimating casualties. This is what you commonly see. 450,000 British, you throw in a couple hundred thousand French, ends up being more like 650,000 killed and wounded from July to November 1916. And then you also have about 450,000 Germans. Now, why is this controversial? The numbers go all over the place. I've seen 600,000 British without even calculating the French in that. I've seen 600,000 Germans. On the first day, we believe, this is an estimate, about 60,000 British casualties, about 8,000 German casualties. It's a huge difference in losses. So why is this controversial? Of course, who knows? who knows if you're going to have how many German casualties there were, except for the Germans. The Germans, of course, have estimates, calculations during the war. But at the end of the war in the early 1920s, the Germans are making official statements and they're counting their losses. And they come out with, well, relatively modest losses compared to what the British have over here. So the British historians call the Germans just a bunch of liars. Well, you're a liar because what you say, I don't want to hear. Now, I'm not going to resolve that controversy for you right today. But I am going to say the Germans come through with their numbers. And the British come through with their numbers of the German dead. Because you can't accept this. Are the Germans lying or are the Germans more accurate? You see, there's a controversy here. Let me talk a little bit about Haig. I called him a butcher. We'll come back and talk about him later on, particularly when we talk about Third Ypres and the Passchendaele, about his leadership. But there is, even today, there's a statue of him at Trafalgar Square in downtown London. I've been there, I've seen it. There's controversy, it's been going for a lengthy period of time. Should we take that thing down? What an absolute insult to our nation. We have that butcher being honored at Trafalgar Square. Now, I told you a few years ago, my oldest son and I, we got on a bus tour. Oh, I had a wonderful time. We went to England and Scotland and Wales and Ireland. Whole big tour. Entire British Isles. Fascinating. When we were in Scotland, I was quite surprised by everything in Britain. Everything's smaller. So I'm an American. I get in the car and we drive forever. And that's just a piece of the United States. And now you can run a 10-day bus tour all over the place here. I was actually surprised when we got to Scotland, hearing so much about Scotland. Scotland's a very interesting place, a beautiful place, but it's not very big. Even since I was a kid in grade school, we're talking about Glasgow and Edinburgh, the big cities. And I go into Edinburgh and I go, that's not a small place. At Edinburgh Castle, which goes back to the Mary Queen of Scots, and very interesting things about her. They have a list of the names of all the Scots that were killed in the First World War. And you have these books of them, room, huge books, alphabetical order. You go in and you look, and 150,000 men, 150,000 men. In a small part of Britain. And I go, my goodness, the casualty figures. Now, the Edinburgh Castle is not just a castle, it is actually a museum complex. A military museum, fascinating, went over to that. They have an equestrian statue, in other words, Sir Douglas Haig, on top of horseback. And I think about the casualty figures back there in the books, and I look at the statue. And I go, well, you can honor that man if you want to. And I think many Scots do not want to honor him. But he doesn't sit very high, in my estimation. The man was a butcher. Now, I'm going to come back and discuss this next time, but we are out of time. In the meantime, I appreciate you. I hope you're enjoying your life. And unfortunately, I have nothing cheerful to say in this class, but we will continue with you when we meet next time. Remember, this is lecture number 21.